This is the second part of a series of trial skills, very practice-oriented presentation presented by Jerry Bruce and Richard Highsmith. I was not available at the last one. I'm not sure how many of you were here, but it was so well received that, we have a part two. And in fact, we're considering continuing this general trend of this series around practice skills. It looks like that's something that you all would continue to be interested in. So we brought back the same esteemed speakers that you all thought were so great last time, and we agree. First, I'll introduce you to Gerald Bruce, goes by Jerry. Jerry was formerly and most recently a juvenile court judge in the Enoda Judicial Circuit. If you're not familiar, that covers the counties of Lumpkin, Towns, Union, and White counties. And in that capacity, of course, he presided over all of the cases that come before the juvenile court, including delinquencies and dependencies and status offense cases. Before that, he was a special assistant attorney general, so he may be in league with some of you in the room. And before that, an assistant district attorney also for the Enoda Judicial Circuit, where he did a special appointment as an appointment as a special drug prosecutor for felony drug crimes. So he has this great breadth of experience across the roles that are available in juvenile court and perspective that comes from that, as well as expertise. He brings all of that to us now that he's in a role with consulting and public policy development, training, and practice exclusively in this area of child welfare law and policy. And for those of you who may also share this as an alumni status, he's graduated from law school at the University of Georgia. We do allow folks here from University of Georgia. Richard Highsmith, I've also gotten to know over the years, and we've presented together. It's been a pleasure. We're glad to have him back. He practices family law in Northeast Georgia, where he does the whole gamut, right? Adoptions and child representation, custody, mediation, also works with local domestic violence agencies. So again, a breadth of perspective and knowledge, depth of knowledge to bring to us today. He currently is a member of the board of directors of the Georgia Association of Counsel for Children and a member of the National Association of Counsel for Children. He too has served as a parent attorney, a children's attorney, a guardian ad litem, and is now a DFACT SAG with extensive experience in juvenile court. So with that, by way of introduction, please help me welcome our two speakers, and I'll turn it to them for part two of our trial skills for child welfare attorneys series. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Well, thanks for coming in on a beautiful Friday. It's much too nice to be inside today, and especially to talk about something that's as potentially dry as evidence. It's really interesting, though, because our part one was a sort of unorthodox approach to trial skills by talking about aspects that we don't usually hear talked about. It's hard to do that when you do evidence, because you got to talk about some of the things that child welfare attorneys are going to encounter. And of course, you can only do that in a really broad overview fashion. So the whole point of these small two-hour classes is to let you just bite off a little bit, just get familiarized with things. There may be some things that seem very basic to you, but everything we address here today is something that either Richard or I or both of us have actually encountered people having trouble with recently in one court or another, either courts we were participating in or courts we were observing or working in. So all these things are live issues that people are struggling with around the state at the moment. So I want to remind you that we talked about, We talked about the making a record last time. And when you make a record, you have to have appropriate evidence to do so. We continue, and when I say we, the juvenile court practitioners, that's the judges, the SAGs, the attorneys, everybody, to get sort of taken to task by the powers that be in Atlanta on the appellate court bench, because we're not making an appropriate record. And a lot of times when we do make a record, that record doesn't actually contain evidence that will allow the finder of fact to make the findings that were made. So that's the consistent complaint of the appellate courts, is that we have these court orders and transcripts that don't actually match one another. We talked about that a lot last time. But having some basic handle on basic evidentiary procedures is a really good way to sort of start to overcome that, to make sure that you make your record, that you take care of those issues as they arise. So that's one of the preliminary things we wanted to talk about. I guess the first thing to do is to go back to a definition of evidence that we used last time when we talked from the Stanford Dictionary of Philosophy, which I always plug. It's a great resource. You can read for hours and hours on the online, and it's totally free. So this evening when you get home, it's Friday night, I know you'll just want to pull up the Stanford Dictionary of Philosophy and you'll want to open a beer and spend some time reading about it. It's really great. But this is an excellent and useful definition of evidence. That which is adduced by a party at the trial or any hearing as a means of establishing factual claims. And you would think, yep, this is pretty simple, this is pretty easy. But we've seen all these appellate court decisions recently where evidence is adduced by a judge who improperly takes notice of something or takes notice of something in an ex parte fashion that was not supposed to be done in an ex parte fashion, or where there's a finding of fact that doesn't actually have any evidence having been adduced that led to that factual claim. So this is a very useful and basic rule of evidence. It's got to be adduced by a party at the trial or hearing, and there has to be some logical connection establishing the factual claims of the party. And we have to always go back to this preliminary thing that we talked about last time. You have to remember the rule is that the court knows nothing but what is put before it. Even in our relatively informal dispositional hearings, court reviews, permanency hearings, things like that, the parties still have to put evidence before the court. The main thing that's relaxed in those hearings is the hearsay rule and the fact that the juvenile code says the court can consider information from a wide variety of sources, but that information still has to be reliable and useful. Its admissibility may be easier than it is in an adjudicatory hearing, but there still has to be evidence put before the court at those hearings. So the court can't just sort of go on his own memory or her own memory or on simple, bare statements of counsel. So the court doesn't know anything. Evidence is how the parties put these facts before the court. And if it hasn't come before the court as evidence, even in an informal setting, it can't be used or considered by the court.
Now, one of the practice points I think you have to keep in mind here is we all come to these hearings and the court is hearing the testimony of a party and just naturally is comparing that with the testimony from a previous proceeding or a previous hearing or something of that nature. And what where the problem would come in is if the court is utilizing that information that's not presented into the record properly. If the court had made a finding of fact at the previous hearing, that order may be appropriate to be received into evidence to show what was the finding at the previous hearing or what the testimony was at the previous hearing. Transcripts of the actual testimony itself, particularly when used for impeachment purposes, would be an appropriate way to get that evidence from the previous hearing into the record on your case, the hearing or the actual hearing itself that you are handling today. You need to have some way of getting that information from your prior findings into the record at the hearing that's before the court, so you're making a proper record of that hearing. Should that be appealed, you want to make sure that the evidence came in properly and it's not just something that the judge thinks it happened at a previous hearing or something of that nature. There needs to be some way of getting that evidence properly before the court so it becomes a part of the record in that hearing should it be appealed or should that finding be necessary for subsequent hearings.
It's really amazing how many times, especially in review hearings and things like that, but sometimes even in adjudicatory hearings, courts make factual findings by way of reminiscence, you know? Well, I remember the last time you were on the stand, Miss So-and-so, and you know, and let me tell you what I've learned from that. You're not reliable or whatever, you know. Those are things the parties have to do. The court can't just sort of pull things out of the hat of its memory, and the parties can't pull things out of the hat of their memories either. There has to be evidence brought before the court, some type of document, some type of stipulation, even in informal hearings. So it may sound like we're beating this to death, but that's because this is a real problem. It happens a lot.
And of course, it could be that you're asking a person about their testimony in the prior hearing and their recollection of their testimony from the prior hearing is used to impeach them and what they just said 10 minutes ago. But there has to be some way for that evidence to get before the court.
So, evidence has to be usable, and so in order for evidence to be usable, it has to meet certain criteria. So the first question we want to ask is, what are the criteria for usable evidence? What does it take for evidence to be usable? And one of the most famous sayings of Leonardo da Vinci is that usable evidence must be relevant. This was just discovered, I think, on a terracotta piece of the back of a sculpture that was demolished in northern Italy, just discovered 5 minutes ago. Leonardo says, usable evidence must be relevant. Okay, so the fact that there's evidence doesn't necessarily mean it's usable, because relevance is the logical connection between the cause of action, what you're trying to establish, and this piece of evidence. Okay, so notice that our evidentiary rule says that evidence which is not relevant is not admissible. So there's no such thing as admissible irrelevant evidence. So we have to make sure we're maintaining the logical connection between the cause of action, the things that we're attempting to prove. Why is this piece of evidence? Why does it tend to show that this child is dependent? Why does it tend to show that there should be a termination of parental rights? Why does it tend to show that a placement change is in the best interest of the child? Those things, relevance. So relevance is pretty basic. One of the most important marks of usable evidence is admissibility. And you would think, well, this just goes without saying, doesn't it? But it's not necessarily true. Evidence can be very relevant and still not admissible because of any number of reasons. That's the very purpose we have this exception in the code that all relevant evidence is admissible unless it's limited by some constitutional requirement or as otherwise provided by law. That's the whole purpose for all the rest of the rules of evidence, okay, is to set forth those rules of law that govern the introduction of evidence that might otherwise be admissible because it's relevant, but it's still not going to come in because of some issue. So think about this when you think about the remaining rules of evidence, because there's a lot of rules of evidence. I mean, you've looked at them probably. Under our new code, there's more than, they're numbered into the thousands. They're not actually 1,000, but I think it's kind of cool when you start citing rule 1,000. It sounds like there's more than there really are. I'm not sure how many there actually are. But yeah, it's a big book. But the main point you have to keep asking yourselves when you talk about any one of these rules, and we're only going to hit the ones that seem to come up most commonly with difficulties in child welfare cases today, is we're looking for reliability and we're looking for verifiability. We're looking for good quality of evidence. That's what we're always asking ourselves. Is this evidence reliable? Can we verify this in some way? And does it tie us to the cause of action? So there's some logical connection. Good quality, that's the reliable and verifiable part. And then a connection, that's our relevance. Okay, so this is the question we're asking in each one of these cases. And this is why we would exclude certain otherwise relevant evidence. For instance, you could have evidence that has been taken from somebody by a law enforcement officer pursuant to an illegal stop and search. That evidence may be very relevant. But it's not going to come in because it's been obtained in violation of a constitutional requirement. Or in an adjudicatory hearing, you may have very relevant evidence that's hearsay, that's been objected to, and it's not going to come in because unless there are other exceptions to the hearsay rule, hearsay that's not objected to is not reliable, it's not verifiable. Somebody may say, well, you know, I got this great witness who said that he saw mom using drugs. Well, that's wonderful, but that person is going to have to come in and testify to that fact unless we stipulate to it, because it's otherwise not reliable. You can't just take people's word off the street for most things.
So how much evidence, you know, what is the quantum of evidence that you have to show? Now, the way that you're looking at reliability when you're talking about something like statistics is a little bit different than the way that you're looking at things whenever you're looking at the law, because I don't think that courts are ever really wanting to quantify evidentiary findings, because it'd be very hard to quantify the impressions of the court and trying to weigh the evidence itself. So when we talk about statistics, we talk about a probability of a certain level. But there's a lot of references to the idea that there's some level which is almost quantifiable about where these evidentiary standards are. And so whenever people are talking about
probable cause. They're probably talking at a very low level, somewhere in the 10, 20, 30% range that there's likelihood that there's good evidence that this happened. Now, this comes into play because the preliminary protective hearing, which is, of course, the first hearing in most of the cases where there's removal to a party, there's a probable cause. That's the finding. It's a very low level of evidence that has to be presented. Now, there has to be evidence. Occasionally you'll hear, and I've heard many times, that there are no rules of evidence in juvenile court. How many times have you all heard that? Or that there's no rules of evidence at certain types of hearings, or that anything is admissible at a preliminary hearing. Well, that's not true. I mean, you still have to have relevance. If it's not relevant evidence, it's not evidence, period. It has to have some degree of reliability. But the level of proof that you have to meet to show probable cause, like when you're obtaining a warrant, is not a very high level of proof. And so at the preliminary protective hearing, it's going to be very low. Now, the most of what you're going to be using in the adjudication and any other hearing in juvenile court past the preliminary hearing is what's called clear and convincing evidence. Now, it's not exactly clear where that level would be, but it's somewhere in between the standard, go back to the total thing, it's somewhere between the standard of a criminal trial, which is beyond a reasonable doubt, which I think most people have characterized as somewhere between 90 and 95%, and the question of a preponderance of the evidence. Now, preponderance is not normally used for the standard of proof for what you're having to prove at trial, but it does have application in juvenile court proceedings because there are some preliminary evidentiary questions where the court's going to find that something can come into evidence, and the standard that they're going to be using is a preponderance. If you're in a divorce action, car wreck, any other civil proceeding, you're most likely looking at just a preponderance of the evidence. Whoever has slightly more than half of the evidence there, 51%, is going to be the person who's going to prevail at that hearing. In a juvenile court proceeding, you have to show by clear and convincing evidence that the dependency is there. And the reason that you have this higher degree of proof is because you are having to abrogate the rights of parents in most of these situations, and in order to do so, there's a constitutional requirement that you have a higher quantum of evidence. Now, where is it? It's somewhere between 50% and 90%. It's somewhere in between beyond a reasonable doubt and a preponderance of the evidence. It's not really clear exactly where it is, and the words clear and convincing evidence are a little bit different than preponderance or beyond a reasonable doubt, because a reasonable doubt would be a very high level, and it would be something that would almost be quantifiable at maybe 1 out of 20 chance that you could be wrong about it. The preponderance of the evidence is easy because you just go right over the line, slightly more than 50%. But clear and convincing sounds like a qualitative rather than a quantitative term in comparison to these other measures, which are more quantitative. So you have to show clear and convincing evidence for every hearing in juvenile court, except for maybe an evidence hearing and the preliminary protective hearing. Now, this is a little confusing because the rules of evidence change slightly when you're looking at reviews and other dispositional hearings. And so a lot of people believe that you don't have to have the same burden of proof if you're the plaintiff in a juvenile case at the permanency hearings or the judicial review hearings than you do at the adjudication hearing, but that's not the case. You just have a different way of bringing in evidence, and you have a much broader scope of what you can bring in without objection. but you still have the same burden of proof, you still have the same standard of proof in every one of the proceedings after a preliminary proceeding.
One thing that I found helpful about clear and convincing evidence was a commentator who said that clear and convincing evidence means that the evidence is substantially more likely to be true than otherwise. So you've got your probable cause standard, you've got your preponderance standard, it's just a little bit more likely. You've got your beyond a reasonable doubt, almost, no question, and that whole hazy area in between, substantially more likely to be true. So we need to talk about now some specific evidentiary issues, and of course we have to have a caveat, since we're lawyers, to say that we can only scratch the surface in the context of this presentation, and that the following points are given as a starting place for your own study. These are not exhaustive. We could spend 2 hours talking about any one of these evidentiary issues that we're going to talk about. All we want to do is generally familiarize you with them. If you find that you're already generally familiar with them, then you can check your email or something like that. But again, the only ones we've raised today, the only ones we're going to discuss are ones we've actually seen people struggle with. So they may seem very simple to you, but somebody somewhere is having difficulty with them. So let's go ahead and look at some specific evidentiary issues. I did want to touch again on what Richard said, that you know there's this unfortunate language in 24.1.2 that says the rules of evidence don't apply in dispositional hearings and custody hearings in juvenile court. And people are like, whoa, so there's no rules of evidence in juvenile court. You read the case law and you read the commentators and you find that nobody actually believes that's true. I mean, we would not be getting our dependency hearings overturned on appeal for lack of appropriate evidence if there were no rules of evidence in juvenile court. I think the only way to make sense of this is to read dispositional hearings and custody hearings as meaning substantially the same thing, because it's at the dispositional phase that a question of custodial relationship is established. It's where the court says, okay, I've decided that this child is dependent or that we're going to terminate parental rights. Now what are we going to do with the child? We can't just put them in a box on the shelf. We have to give them to somebody. We should also be cautious about saying that this doesn't mean there's any evidence in juvenile court, because the appellate courts continually say that really dependency hearings and termination hearings are not custody proceedings. So they're very insistent about that fact. These are not custody cases. So what's a custody case in juvenile court? Well, it's either a dispositional phase or it's nothing. And we're not supposed to read statutes as if our legislatures meant nonsense, which is funny because I think a lot of times they really do. But we're not supposed to do that. We're not allowed to in the canons of statutory construction. So I think we just have to say that this means the same thing, that a dispositional hearing and a custody hearing is the same thing. And maybe we should ask, maybe Melissa should ask them to get rid of that language to make it much more clear later.
Well, one thing I want to point out is a good way of looking at it is to say that the court, of course, has to have certain threshold findings of fact in order to limit a party's rights, even on a temporary basis. That is, those are the facts that have to be found at the adjudication and also at a termination of parental rights. The court has to find facts about dependency, about the nature of the dependency, the length of which the dependency is likely to last, and those facts enable the court to then make decisions as to what's in the best interest of the child and what to do with the child. So you have to, the rules of evidence are always going to imply whenever you are making findings about the fact that there is dependency there in the case. So once there's a finding, a fact that there's dependency, then the court can then proceed to figure out what's going to be in the best interest of the child at that point. At that point, the evidence rules change. They're not as strict as to what can come in, and other things that you would not have been able to get in at the adjudication phase of the case are then admissible, because it's really in the best interest of the child that the court have a complete picture as to what to do dispositionally with the child by being able to get in evidence that you could not get when you're trying to adjudicate the case, like a stack of medical reports this thick without somebody there to testify as to what's in those medical reports.
So I said a minute ago that we wanted to keep the big picture in mind with regard to these evidentiary rules, that what we're looking for is good, reliable evidence, valid evidence that's related to our case. But there's a couple of even larger justice issues that I think we should always keep in mind when we talk about these things. And these sort of larger issues are things that practitioners tend to not simply have the leisure to contemplate. And since you're blowing a lovely Friday afternoon, here you have the leisure. Let's contemplate them for about 10 seconds. The first one is we have a large jurisprudential goal in seeing that we have informed judicial decision-making, right? I mean, we don't want judges making decisions on bad evidence because they're going to make bad decisions. We don't want them making decisions based on cruddy performance by attorneys because they're not going to be getting, they may be relying on unreliable information because nobody objects. They may be relying upon poor causation, strings of causation because nobody stands up and says this isn't relevant. They may not realize that their own decisions when they announce their findings of fact and conclusions of law don't really match up. So I always go back to this idea that you should always ask a court to give oral findings of fact and conclusions of law at the end of every single hearing. Otherwise, somebody's going and making up a court order out of whole cloth and presenting it to the judge. So we want informed judicial decision making, and a good handle on evidence is important. But we also want a uniform experience of justice. We don't want people who can afford to hire attorneys to get better representation than people who have appointed counsel. That's not uniform justice. It's not justice at all. We don't want people in one county to have bad outcomes because nobody knows what's going on. They don't understand the rules of evidence. They don't know when to object. And in another county to have a higher quality of attorney where we have better outcomes. It's not a uniform experience of justice. We can't ever provide for perfect uniformity, but we want some real uniformity. And right now, we don't have anything even approaching that. I mean, we have such a patchwork of results, abilities all over. And it's not just within one county. You would expect in any given jurisdiction to have a wide variety of experience where people are learning. That's okay. You have to go through those experiences to learn. But you shouldn't be able just to go from one county to another and get wildly different results on the same facts. And I think right now you can do that. So we want to have reliable decision making and a uniform experience of justice. And that's our overarching goal.
I was just going to say, and just from my experience as a SAG and also as a child and parent attorney, there are plenty of people who should have stuck with their appointed counsel, because a lot of times your appointed counsel, your public defender, knows a whole lot more about what's going on in juvenile court than the person who's just coming in there to make a quick buck, thinking they're coming into a courtroom that doesn't have any rules of evidence or something of that nature. And so the uniformity in the outcomes for the parties, and the uniform doesn't necessarily mean that it follows the money, but it does follow the training and experience of the attorneys themselves, which could be from private counsel or it could be from appointed counsel. But whatever it is, people need to have uniformly good access to counsel. And I say that as an attorney for the Department of Family and Children Services as much as just somebody who has been in general practice before, because I would much prefer to deal with a situation where somebody has an attorney who knows what they're doing in this case, because then it's not going to create the problem of somebody having made errors or things like that and resulted in maybe inadmissible evidence being the basis of what the court makes the finding of fact for.
So first, let's talk about hearsay and its common exceptions. And this means, in the context of child welfare cases, there are a boatload of exceptions to the hearsay rule. And we're not going to talk about all of those because most of them don't commonly occur in our cases. So let's talk about the ones that most commonly do. And first, let's talk about the fact that the admissibility of hearsay is really the one characteristic of all of our non-adjudicatory hearings in juvenile court. So this is what is really going on when people think there's no evidence in these hearings. Well, there are rules of evidence, but they're relaxed, and hearsay is admissible. And even in adjudicatory hearings, of course, since 2013, hearsay that's not timely objected to is admissible. It's no longer hearsay. It's competent, relevant, well, it's not necessarily relevant, but it's competent original evidence. So this change that mirrors the federal rules is really a good one for attorneys because it allows us to really practice our craft. There may be times when you want that hearsay to come in, but it also means you have to pay attention because you can't rely on a judge anymore to say, that's hearsay, and I'm not paying any attention to that. You need to stand up and let them know that you don't want this hearsay coming in. Otherwise, it will. So it does give a lot more scope for the attorney's creativity and trial skills. It also creates more of a burden on the attorney to actually be paying attention and not playing Tetris or something like that during the hearing.
Looking at Facebook is probably the biggest problem.
Yeah, looking at Facebook is a really big problem. Or texting the other attorney across the way.
Although they might be texting about, don't you need to object to this? That
right.
Might be appropriate.
Object. So hearsay, it's really wonderful. Our Rule 801 is excellent because before in Georgia, for 150 years, our hearsay statute definition didn't include the word statement anywhere in it. So it's really nice to have a hearsay statute that actually talks about statements. And so hearsay is any statement other than one made by the declarant, that's the person who made the statement originally, while testifying at trial or hearing, that's offered in evidence to prove the truth of the matter asserted. So remember, you all know this, I'm sure, what sounds like hearsay that is offered for any other purpose is not hearsay. It may be inadmissible for other reasons, but it's not hearsay. So a statement by somebody else offered to explain conduct. Why did you run? Well, I ran because he said he was going to shoot me. Well, it's not hearsay. That's something offered to explain my conduct, and it's perfectly admissible as long as there's no other reason to keep it out. So to prove the truth of the matter asserted. Statements, it makes clear under our new code, following the federal rules, can be oral or written or even nonverbal. So this is a statement for purposes of hearsay, okay? He pointed at John Smith in the lineup. He didn't say anything, but when asked who did it, he did this. So for purposes of hearsay, that's a statement, okay? So that, if objected to in an adjudicatory hearing, would not come in because it's hearsay. We don't often think about that, but it's certainly true. Anything someone does that intends to make a statement of some type is hearsay. We deal a lot with public records, so that's the first real major exception we wanted to talk about. We deal with the Department of Family and Children Services. You may deal with law enforcement agencies, things like that. There's a public records exception to hearsay, and I don't see this used very often, and I have seen it used with great effect before, but I don't see it used very often because all those records that are kept by the department, all the way from phone logs of contacts, all the way down to the results of investigations, things like that, are not hearsay. So they don't have to be particularly, you don't have to have somebody come in and authenticate those things. These are public records, okay? They may not be admissible for other reasons, they may not be relevant, but they're not hearsay. They're not subject to a hearsay objection. So all those, I know you're asking for discovery in all your cases, so when you get all that discovery from the department, those documents, if they fall under the public records exception, are not subject to a hearsay objection. And a lot of people don't use that. The next big area is business records. We deal very frequently with business records in defects cases, in our TPR and in our in our dependency cases, we deal with things like phone records, and we deal with electric bills, and payments made and not made, and rent, and things like that. So business records, if they meet these criteria, are not subject to the hearsay rule because we talked about we want reliability, verifiability. It's the same idea with public record, that if you have a public official who's charged with making particular notations, observations, findings, writing things down, and their job depends on it, that they're very likely to do it right most of the time. Same thing in a business sense. People whose livelihood depends upon their making notations of routine transactions that they wouldn't necessarily independently remember later, but you need to have a record of. Those we generally hold to be reliable. People don't normally make those kinds of things up. So as long as the entry, whatever it is, whether it's a notation that mom came in and paid the electric bill on June the 1st or some other type of business record, as long as it was made at or near the time of the source activity, whatever that activity is we're memorializing, as long as it's contemporaneous, close to the time it was done. So mom came in on the 1st at 9 a.m. and at 10 a.m. the clerk wrote all that down and entered it in. You've got a good thing. If she came in at 9 a.m. on June the 1st and it didn't get written down for 6 months when suddenly she remembered, oh, I think she came in 6 months ago, we're not talking about a contemporaneous activity. Personal knowledge by the person who's writing it down and a duty to write it down. So that's what my job is. I'm supposed to write it down when people come in and pay. That's what I get paid to do. So I have to write those things down and I have personal knowledge. That personal knowledge can actually come directly from my interacting with the person who came in and paid. Or it can be if there's another person sitting next to me who has the same job and the same duty who tells me when I come back from my break, mom just came in and paid her electric bill, I can note that down. That personal knowledge can come from somebody else who's under the same obligations and duties that I am who also has that and transmits that to me. So there's some real latitude here. These records have to be records that are kept in the course of regularly conducted business activity, and that it's the regular practice of the business to keep these records. So this is what we do. We keep these records as part of our business. We always keep these records. We don't just keep them sometimes. This is what we do on a day-to-day basis. That's why these records are deemed to be reliable. So business records are not subject to a hearsay exception, and they can be certified as follows. We're going to talk in a minute about the fact that that we need in all of these cases to know that the piece of evidence we're dealing with is what it purports to be. So this is something we're going to come back to after we talk about photographs and things like that. Keep in mind this requirement that we need to know that these things are what they purport to be. So the reason these things are not hearsay in the business record sense is that it used to be, I remember when I was in the DA's office, when we had to have somebody's phone records, we always had to have somebody from the phone company come in and authenticate those records. And it was a real pain. And we had to have somebody from the electric company come in. And we had to have people come in and do all this authentication. And it was always really difficult. And it was just a pain. It was boring to sit through. And if it was a jury trial, it was even worse because the jurors were falling asleep. And it's just difficult to keep people's attention when this is going on, kind of like coming to an evidence seminar. But there's a shortcut now to allow these things to come in without somebody coming to do that because of this reliability issue. So you can have a declaration or certification that the record, this is the stuff that we just talked about, that it's contemporaneous, based on personal knowledge, kept in the course of regularly conducted activity and made as part of the regular business practice. If that's on the top of this sheet of bills coming in from the electric company, certified from somebody there with personal knowledge, this is what we do, it's contemporaneous, it's all of these things, then there's no hearsay objection. Okay, there may be some other objection, but there's no hearsay objection. The only thing you have to do when you do this is to give advance notice of the declaration and the accompanying record to the other parties in the case to say, okay, here I'm going to be tendering these bills, and here's how I'm going to get them in.
Now, there may be some very basic and critical things that come into a dependency hearing that would be able to come in with certification of a business record. So, for example, if the case plan required that a parent attend a certain number of sessions with a counselor, then the fact that the person did or did not attend those sessions is going to be reflected in the billing records when they're sending the bill to the Department of Family and Children Services to account for whether or not the person arrived and whether or not there's some billing item that would be reportable there. That would be the sort of thing that would be kept in the regular course of business, because it's a regular course of business for a counseling firm to send a bill in response to an authorization for services from the department, and that's going to reflect the attendance records themselves. Now, that's not necessarily going to account for everything in the case, but it is going to be able to get at least the records of, you know, did somebody attend or something like that. And of course, you know, that would be very commonly used by the department, but it could also be used to rebut allegations that a person did not attend if those records can be produced for the parent or for another party in the case.
Okay, so those were some big ones. Public records, business records, those things come in all the time. You may use these all the time. If you don't, you can make a note of these rules and find them very useful. There's another area that I don't see used very often, another exception I don't see used very often that bears directly on what we do in dependency and TPR cases all of the time. And it is an exception for someone's reputation concerning personal or family history. And this is really useful for us because we have a lot of folks that come to our courts and we don't really know all we need to know about their background. We don't really know what their relationship to the child is, for example. And it is not hearsay to put forth evidence of someone's reputation among the members of the family by blood, adoption, or marriage, or by their close associates in the community concerning someone's birth, adoption, marriage, divorce, death, legitimacy. These are questions we have to answer a lot of times. Sometimes you can get, you know, a mother's affidavit that says, yes, I was married to Mr. Schmuck at the time the child was born. And sometimes you can't because you can't find mom because she's gone to ground and she's off running. And so you can use the testimony of other people about whether the child was born as a result of a marriage or not, was legitimate or not, whether there was an adoption or not. Now, what weight and credibility to give to that evidence obviously goes to the court, but it's not hearsay to have that information come in. And we need this information a lot, and I don't see this used very often, and it's very useful to at least get us where we need to be so courts can start to make basic findings of fact about the relationship between family members. So this is something that's very useful.
Particularly, I think it could be useful in those situations where the person doesn't know how to get the affidavit of paternity and things of that nature. Maybe they could testify as to it. It may not establish it sufficiently to show those facts by clear and convincing evidence, but at least, you know, it might get your foot in the door so they can go down to vital records and try to get that record. Question.
It's a public record, right? And so you have to ask yourself if it meets those requirements of a public record. Is it made by somebody whose duty it is to make that record? Is it part of their job to make that record? For most incident reports, the answer is yes. And is it made fairly contemporaneously with the incident? Most of the time, yeah. So I've always argued that in civil cases in general and in dependency and TPR cases that the incident reports are not hearsay. It might be something else. Sometimes they're just useless. sometimes they say, I stopped the defendant and arrested him.
So if we can't get the officer there, at least we have that officer. So there's no like Crawford issue with that?
Not in a civil case.
Right. Yeah. I keep forgetting that.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, you have the opportunity to confront anything in that by subpoenaing the party who wrote the report, which of course you always do. Even if these records come in and you don't agree with what's in the record, you could always send a subpoena to whoever generated that if you feel that it's inaccurate, and then of course ask them about that incident. And of course, if that's already in the record, that person testifies differently, well, you have quite a good basis for impeachment of that witness if the record's already in that they generated.
I think there's a really good argument that those come in.
So medical narrative reports. Now, there's a big caveat for this because under the evidence code, and it's codified at 24.8.826, there's a 60-day time frame by which you can seek the introduction of a medical narrative. So, I mean, we've got adjudications. Most of the time, they're happening well before 60 days. So, I don't know what if you based. Who's regularly having them after 60 days? Okay, maybe you could use it if you're going to have the ability to bring that in.
But, or in cases where you have a lot of medical evidence, sometimes you're continuing them until you can get that medical evidence.
Right.
So that's going to happen. Or if you're in a particular circuit, I know of where cases don't get resolved in anything under 24 months, you can use this as well.
Sure. But it's in any civil proceeding involving injury or disease. So if there's a question about injury or disease, and of course we have so many of these cases that involve medical records because there's a child injury, or there's a failure to treat disease which is resulting in some kind of medical neglect. And that's a very, very common sort of things that we see in juvenile court proceedings. So I think it'd probably be applicable to a lot of cases if it were used. And any medical report in narrative form, signed and dated by the person that's giving their medical opinion or giving this report. Now, narrative form essentially means that it's a story. It has to be something which is a narrative. It's not just a blanket list of, you know, here's the diagnostic codes, you know, I certify this. It's got to be an actual story. It has to tell you something about it. It can be from just about any medical professional, including an advanced practice nurse, registered professional counselor, social worker, or professional counselor. You could also have it from a chiropractor, podiatrist. All sorts of medical professionals can generate these reports.
Social worker.
Social worker, there's a licensed clinical social worker that's, is it a social worker maybe who's working for a medical office or a hospital? Maybe they could generate the report themselves. It is admissible and received into evidence as though the professional signing the report were present at trial. And, really this is most commonly used in the context of probably personal injury cases and things of that nature. Probably ones where you have a fairly low threshold of damages such that it would not be practical for the parties to bring the medical professionals in for 3 days of trial to ask them about what happened to the injury on the knee. You know, that's going to be a case that's not going to justify having the doctor there probably for 3 or 4 days. Instead, bring in the medical narrative from the doctor themselves. It may represent the history, examination, diagnosis, treatment, prognosis, or interpretation of tests or examinations and a basis for the opinion, and may opine as to the etiology, the cause of the injury or disease. Now, in order to get that, you're going to have to send it, and it has to include a statement of the professional's qualifications. You must provide the adverse party with a report 60 days prior to trial. There's your problem in most of our juvenile court proceedings. You know, you're supposed to be having these things within maybe 15 days of your PPH, so you're not going to be able to use them in most of those cases. However, I think you could easily use them in a lot of termination of parental rights cases because you could sufficiently know in advance that there will be a termination of parental rights filed, submit that, and oftentimes the TPR hearings themselves are going to be conducted more than 60 days after the initial date of filing. So in those cases, it may be more likely to be able to use these medical narratives. The adverse party must object to the admissibility of any portion of the report other than an objection to hearsay. So they can't just file an objection and say, well, I don't want this to come in, this is hearsay. Well, that's the whole point, is you're trying to get hearsay into evidence in a way that it's going to be reliable. Now, the sort of objection that may be proper is, well, this doctor actually had their medical license revoked, or you know, maybe it's an improper conclusion that they reached about the evidence itself. And they have to object within 15 days of being provided with the report. If you don't lodge an objection within 15 days, then from what I've read in the case law, most of those items are going to be admissible, even if you go back and say, well, they didn't put their professional qualifications in there. Well, the courts have said, well, you waived it. You could have objected and said there were no professional qualifications listed in that medical narrative. The adverse party may call the witness to cross-examine her. So you got a doctor, and she's submitted the medical report. The other side doesn't like it. Well, the other side can always subpoena that doctor and then ask her, okay, so doc, you've reached this conclusion. Why did you reach that? Did you consider, you know, this evidence or these things that are in the record? So you can, you always have a way around that, even if it is going to come into the record. The adverse party may provide rebuttal testimony, maybe a rebuttal report in the same format. And the way the statute reads, it reads that these things are being presented to the jury. But I think that it probably would be able to be presented to the court. But it's read into the testimony just as you would a deposition evidence. You can read that into the record itself. So let's look at some examples.
This is really useful because nobody, have you ever seen anybody use this before? I mean, nobody uses this. We deal with medical evidence and testimony all the time, and nobody uses this. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. So, I mean, because I haven't seen any bars or caveats. So, I mean, theoretically, if you had medical records or evidence and you had somebody that you were using, I mean, they could essentially evaluate your records for you, do this, create the report, and this could be used. So it's not that this report has to be just kind of generated by a third party independently. Like, you can get this record made if you need it.
Sure. So so let's say the case is about an injury to a child. The injury, you know, the appropriate sort of person to ask would be the treating physician at the ER. You could ask the treating physician at the ER, hey, buddy, I'm not sure if the county's going to authorize me to pay you, but I'm going to subpoena you for court anyway and to testify as to your factual observations when the child came in. Would you rather submit a medical narrative report, you know, to the court? In that situation, they would just need to make sure that there's a report that's prepared, and that report has to be prepared in anticipation of the litigation to address the issues that are relevant before the court. So you would use it in the context in which you would normally bring in a live witness to testify about the facts in the case.
It's not medical records, it's a medical narrative. Which is what the next set of slides all deal with.
These are the narratives themselves, and they're very short narratives, but of course that's just for the presentation. Dr. Physician MD, the attached medical reports and hospital records set forth the treatment provided to the minor child. Injuries are as described therein, and I incorporate my opinion as to the cause of these injuries from these records herein. Does this come in? Why not?
It's not a story.
It's no story. It's got to be a story. It's not a story. It's just, hey, look at these records. That would be like bringing in the business records. You know, and you're not going to be able to get the medical opinion in through the business records exception in that fashion. Dr. Chiropractor, the child had contusions, commonly called bruises, along his back and neck. I believe that these were caused by belt, cord, strap, and do not show signs of being accidental injuries. What do you think? Does that come in? Absolutely. It's in plain language. It's easy to understand. And I'm assuming Dr. Chiropractor is going to say, I went to, you know, such and such university and am licensed, you know, and that sort of thing in the narrative itself. But as long as it's met the other qualifications, this is exactly the sort of thing that's going to be able to come in to establish the facts of injury or a medical problem in a case. Dr. Neurologist, the child's intracranial hematoma was likely caused by rapid acceleration and deceleration of the cranial vault. The CT scan showed bilateral enlargement of the ventricles, which is of unknown etiology. Further study is necessary to rule out a non-accidental traumatic event. What do you think?
I
That is not going to be admissible because it's not something that the trier of fact is going to be. And I may have left something off the slide there, but there is a requirement that it has to be comprehensible to a layperson. So you have to have, it has to be comprehensible. This doesn't even make sense to me. I just made up a bunch of words and threw it on a page. But it has to be something that does not require the medical professional to testify to. Now, the medical professional may testify about what was in this report if they're actually there and live, and that may be able to cure the problem if it's hyper-technical or something like that. But I think that's probably not going to be able to be admitted. And the final one here, hospital social worker, LCSW. The child presented at the hospital with 106 degree fever, which is a serious fever for a child of this age. He was dehydrated and lethargic. Child was administered Tylenol, cold water, and was provided with cold rags to put on his face and head. The fever subsided. In my opinion, the fever was easily treatable and could have been prevented with proper medical treatment. What do y'all think? Yeah, I think most likely this is the sort of thing that's going to come in. And this is also probably something that's going to be easy to obtain as well, because it's very easy oftentimes to reach the social worker or someone working in that capacity, the hospital, whereas it may require an awful lot of arm twisting to be able to get something from the doctor at the hospital. Sure.
Sometimes I receive medical records, and within the medical records, there are narratives inside the medical records. Like therapist notes, or the social worker from Choa
right.
has some type of notes in there, and
sure.
it looks like a narrative. Can we use that?
Well, I think that you could use that, but you would have to make that a part of a narrative that's prepared for the trial itself. So you can't just say, well, this is the narrative that was here, and so I'm going to use this narrative in lieu of having the doctor or the nurse practitioners or whoever's writing that coming and testifying. But I think if you were to just take that narrative that's in the record, copy that over to an affidavit that sets forth everything else that you need to do under 24-826, put all that information, including those really good juicy narrative parts that you got from the record itself, I think then you could seek to have that admitted and considered by the court. Because I agree, there are plenty of narrative elements in a lot of these reports, sometimes that use very plain language. The other thing that you might want to do is just make sure that they reduce it to lay terms that anybody can understand, because a lot of times in the context there, I mean, you may understand it, you might have a background in health sciences somewhere, but or your medical dictionary sitting next to you, you know, at your desk, but you would probably need to make sure that they put that in a language that would be easily comprehensible by, you know, lawyers who, you know, aren't MDs or nurses. Question?
I just have a practical question, because when you're talking about dealing with doctors and preparing narratives and whatnot for court, and if you're an appointed attorney, I mean, they don't come cheap. So
right.
Talk about that aspect of it. How do you...
Well, and the question...
Most of the time,
right. Well, and the question, just because I think we're supposed to be relating it back onto the microphone so that they can hear it for the recording itself, and I apologize if I haven't done that previously, but the question is, it's very impractical to try to get a doctor to come, particularly when it's an appointed case and you don't have access to, you know, unlimited funds, and just getting beyond just getting the records and getting the medical professional to engage with the case. You know, how do you do that as a practical matter? And I just from experience, it's very hard. I mean, even for people working for the Department of Family and Children's Services, sometimes it's very hard to get the doctors to engage in the case and respond to subpoenas and things like that. I think that one tactic that you can use, of course, is to ask for a, make motions with your judge to make sure that you're authorized to have funding to be able to seek an expert opinion. That's something that I've done in cases where, I thought that I was going to need a medical expert. Make a motion so that you can have access to a medical expert. And then, just as a hypothetical, even if the court can only provide you with X amount of dollars, whether or not they should be doing that is another question, you may be able to get enough that you could ask somebody to prepare a medical narrative and then seek to introduce that.
Especially if they know that the preparation of that medical narrative may relieve them from your subpoena.
That, of course, is probably one of the biggest concerns, because when you subpoena doctors, and this is regardless of whether or not it's a juvenile court case or a superior court case, you will get complaints. You will hear that they have taken leave for some holiday that you can't find on anyone's calendar.
They will be bankrupted by having to come to court.
They will be bankrupted by spending the morning in court. Their medical practice will have to close.
Can you ghostwrite it for them as long as they adopt it?
Well, they're professionals, right? I mean, everybody who's on the list is a professional. So the question is, will they sign something that you ghost wrote for them? And if it's accurate, you would hope that the professional, having read that, would say, well, you said it better than I could have. Sign it, give it to you. Otherwise, maybe they'll rewrite it. They'll mark it up and they'll say, I didn't mean to say, bilateral incision. I meant to say unilateral incision. Send it back to me with the corrections made, and then I'll sign it for you.
The only requirement in the statute is that it has been signed and dated by that person.
Right.
There's no requirement that they actually write it, because of course they know these folks are not going to write their own reports. Somebody's doing it for them. So the only requirement is that they sign and date it.
Yeah, and again, you would. That would come back to their professionalism, whether or not, they can accurately state that this is indeed what had occurred. And particularly with your example, I'm sorry, what was your name?
Jamila.
Jimmy?
Jamila Bear.
Jamila. Jamila's example was of taking those medical narrative portions of the report that are already there, summarizing those and giving it right back to him to sign. I think that would be a terrific way to do it, because you could say, well, I just got this off of page 15. Of this record here where you wrote it all down. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, they would pretty much have to say, yeah, I meant it then, I mean it now. So I think that'd be a good way to handle it.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, when I'm admitting this into evidence, so do I just simply state, Your Honor, I have this document, this is what it is, the parties have, already read this document, and then mm-hmm. I just read it into the evidence myself?
I think that's probably the best way to handle it, because the way it speaks about it, it's like you're reading it into testimony like you do with a deposition. There was a termination of parental rights case I handled years ago. We had somebody who had moved way out of state, they're somewhere in the Northeast or something like that, but hey, guess what? They're coming to Western North Carolina for a conference in 2 weeks. Everybody agreed that this was a necessary person. She had, conducted a forensic examination of the child in a termination case. We all stipulated that we would do a deposition at the courthouse in Franklin, North Carolina, Macon County. And then once we got those deposition transcripts, each one of us could read into evidence the evidence that the portions of the transcript that we wanted the court to consider, in lieu of having this person who is out of state and beyond the subpoena power of the court and was not going to come back for our trial. That was our way of getting around that. I think that you would probably in the courtroom handle that in a very similar way. You would ask the court to you would read into the record certain portions of it, highlight certain portions of it. You, of course, would have to tender those portions to the court, publish it to the parties, and have that tendered into evidence and made a part of the record in the case.
And make sure it's admitted before you read it into the record.
Yes, absolutely. Again, you know, proper admission of that record, and then read that portion of it. Make that portion part of your closing argument. You know, the records from that part of your closing arguments, and so as far as getting it to the parties, just, you know, there I think you just simply make sure that you have a certificate of service that clearly sets forth, I emailed it to Jane on, you know, the 12th of May, and it's been more than 60 days. And once it's been more than 60 days, you just seek to admit it. And, you know, if they didn't object to it, then you argue, because they might argue that it shouldn't be admissible for some other reason, but then you just argue, well, they never submitted any response to it at all, and under the statute, now it's supposed to come in and be considered by the court. They can, if they disagree with it, subpoena this professional to come in and provide some other testimony that's contrary to this. And the unfortunate thing is the statute has this big 60-day window, a 15-day window, which is probably a little bit close to the time frames we're supposed to be dealing with for the objection to it. But because of that 60-day window, a lot of the cases where that would normally be very helpful for showing dependency issues exist are precluded just because of the time frames in the juvenile court proceedings.
If you have a case that's running on and you have medical evidence and testimony, this can be a really good tool, and it's like some of the things we've brought up already, very seldom used by our practitioners. So we have friends that practice personal injury law, and they use these things. They love them.
Because like I say, if you got a case where the damages are $25,000, you're not probably going to want to bring in, you know, six MDs. You're going to spend more on the medical testimony than you'd ever spend on the testimony itself. And in a lot of ways, sometimes these witnesses, when they do come in juvenile proceedings, are terribly expensive for whoever's seeking that, and it makes it a real hardship for somebody who's either indigent or near indigent and is unable to really provide for, I mean, they may be able to hire an attorney, but can they hire an attorney and two expert witnesses as well? That may be beyond the power of people who don't qualify for indigent defense, but yet aren't super rich as well.
Okay, so continuing with our broad overview, let's move from hearsay and its exceptions for a moment to, there's one sort of glaring hearsay thing that I haven't talked about, and you may wonder about it, and we'll come back to it a little bit later. But right now, let's go and talk about common problems people deal with authentication and identification. I always find that there's a lot of difficulty with attorneys in juvenile court with things that are fairly simple, like authentication and identification. So I just want to talk about the most common ones that I've seen, both as a practitioner and sitting on the bench, people struggling with. First, voice and handwriting identification does not require an expert witness. And a lot of people don't know this. They get asked questions all the time. I hear people saying all the time when somebody's trying to get in handwriting evidence, well, did you have a handwriting identification class? No. Well, then I object to this. And I've seen judges, you know, waffle all over the place about this. No expert opinion is required. This is simply based on familiarity. Remember, there are two types of opinions that you can use in our evidence code. There's lay opinion and there's expert opinion. And we tend to just sort of get this idea that when we talk about opinions, we need experts. And that's not true. Anyone with sufficient opportunity to observe can testify as to things that are within common knowledge or that they have familiarity with. So for instance, like distance. How far away were you from him? I was 6 feet away. Have you had some distance measuring and calculating classes? No, but I've, you know, been alive for a while and I can tell 6 feet. How fast do you think that car was going? I think he was going 80 miles an hour. Well, did you have a laser to, you know, detect what he was doing? Nope, I didn't, but you know, I've seen a lot of traffic and I drive a lot, so that's fine. Size, identity of a person, whether somebody's intoxicated or not. I mean, these are common areas of lay opinion. And, you know, to identify someone's voice and handwriting simply requires testimony that the person has been familiar with them before, has seen them before, and that these samples comport with those. So you don't have to have experts to get in voice and handwriting. And we deal with that a lot because, you know, we have, I mean, we probably all had, you know, the cell phone answering message played into the record. If you haven't, you probably will before long. And so this is, doesn't require any expert opinion whatsoever. We've already talked about public documents. When you have a certified public document, this includes your prior court records and things like that. No authenticating witness is required. So you've got these certified copies. They just come in, okay? The court can do what the court will with them, but they come in, okay? They're not subject to objections for authenticity or hearsay or anything else. They may be not relevant, perhaps, but they're going to come in otherwise. Same thing with those certified records of regularly conducted activity, those business records that have the declaration or certification. You don't have to have that witness there. So as long as they're otherwise admissible, they're going to come in. You don't have to worry about those things. Those are things that we deal with a lot and that a lot of people have some issues with. So I hope you don't, and I hope if you did, you don't anymore. How about writings and recordings? Because under our new code, writing and recording means a much broader set of things than just writing something down on a piece of paper or typing something out on a typewriter or even printing something out. You know, writing is something more than just a piece of paper with characters on it, and a recording as well. It's any type of recording of information consisting of letters, words, numbers, or their equivalent that's put down by handwriting, typewriting, printing, photo stating, which that's a nice old-fashioned word for a photocopy, magnetic impulse. So magnetic impulse and mechanical or electronic recording. Magnetic impulses is computer data, right? Mechanical or electronic recording or other form of data compilations. So you can have a writing that looks very different than the type of writings we've dealt with. So for instance, if I see this when I'm looking on Facebook and I print this out and I bring it in, let's just assume that, you know, it's relevant somehow.
See how that's relevant to anything.
And I bring it in and I say, you know, I saw this. This is exactly what it looked like. And this piece of paper accurately reflects it. And it hasn't been changed or deleted or anything. Well, then that's a writing for purposes of this. Okay? Yes?
Is there any particular rule that you can point us to here?
I'm talking about 901. Rule 901, okay? So I don't know if you have this, but in the court that I worked in, we had these really fantastic CASAs, and they would spend large amounts of time in court going on the public Facebook pages of the parents who would come before us because the parents were not smart enough to make their Facebook pages private, and they would put all kinds of bizarre things on there. Richard and I once had a case in Superior Court together that involved a parent who put herself on there with a baby sitting in her lap and the baby holding the bottle of beer, and she's saying, I'm completely wasted.
That was MySpace, so it may date it a little bit.
Yeah, that may date it a little bit, yeah. So, but that's a writing, you know, you print that out, you bring it in, it's a writing. People struggle with this. They're like, how do I get that in? You know, it's off of a web page. Well, you print it out, it's a writing, okay? And we'll talk again about the little hoops you have to go through later, but that's a writing. This is a writing. Right? If I have a screenshot of this, or if I want to introduce my telephone, and I print this out and bring this in, this is a writing.
The spelling's better than most of the writings like this.
That's right.
Evidence.
I mean, text messages are becoming increasingly relevant in many of our cases to prove all kinds of interesting things. And this is a writing. I mean, it may be subject to all kind of rebuttal, like, well, you know, somebody took my phone away from me and was writing all this down, but, you know, it's going to come in as a writing, and then you're going to argue about its reliability later. But it's a writing, okay? Yes, ma'am.
With question, with respect to that, and especially the Facebook stuff, it's a writing. Is it a writing that you have to pull off yourself? Because what we have sometimes is that, you know, family members will come in and say, I saw this on Facebook, and or say they bring in the Facebook page. It's a writing, but it's not one that you yourself pulled off.
Well, let me come, can I come back to that in just a second? Because the same answer is going to apply to photographs as well. So let me just come back to this in a second. So photographs include all kinds of things that we might not think of as photographs, including videos. So really, these videos you take with your phone, those are photographs for purposes of the evidence code. X-rays, those are photographs for purposes of the code. So for purposes of our evidence code, this is a photograph. So what do you do with those things? That's the question that we had asked a minute ago that I deferred for a second. What do you do if somebody else saw this or whatever? With all of these types of authentication questions for these, the question is, someone has to be able to say this accurately reflects the reality. Okay? I mean, I've actually watched in a criminal case once an assistant DA bring up a stack of photographs and get completely derailed because somebody said, because he immediately asked the person who was going to authenticate these things, so when did you take these photographs? And the guy said, I didn't take those photographs. And just like, when I was in college, I was a DJ, and they used to always say, you know, the worst thing you never have is dead air. Well, the same thing happens when you're cross-examining a witness in front of a jury. Dead air is really bad. There's no requirement that the person doing the authenticating haven't taken the photographs or pulled up the web page themselves or made the video, but they have to have observed the things that are recorded there. So they have to be able to say, well, you know, I didn't pull this up, but I did just look at it myself, and it's exactly the same, and this is what I saw. I didn't make that recording of that poor girl falling on her face, but I was there, and I saw it. And that's exactly what happened. I didn't take this photograph, but I saw this house at the time this photograph was taken, and that's what it looked like. So here's the requirement. The requirement is just evidence sufficient to support a finding that the matter in question is what its proponent claims. That's it. Anything, any type of evidence you can bring in to show this is what we say it is going to be relevant. And here, the question when you're talking about whether something's admissible or not, the burden, the quantum of proof required is preponderance of the evidence, right? We mentioned that a little bit earlier. So it's a much lower standard. All you have to do is show that it's more likely that it is what it says it is than that it's not. So you don't have to be the person who actually generated this piece of evidence, but you have to have seen or heard what's recorded in it at the time it was recorded. And you can say, yep, that's what I heard. That's what it sounded like. That's what it looked like when this was done. Yes, ma'am.
So if, as the attorney, I'm the one who did look at the Facebook page and print out the screenshot, who do I question to get that in?
Now, because you don't want to take the stand, because then you can't be
right.
the attorney
right.
anymore.
So do I have to, like, email the case manager and be like, please, I've asked you 5 times, look at this.
Yeah. Yes. You got to have somebody who can say.
So the question was, okay.
Sorry, I didn't repeat the question.
So you have a page from a Facebook page that you want to introduce into evidence, assuming that somebody is going to object to that coming in, you would then maybe have somebody else who, you know, question is how do you get that in without being the person to take the stand and say, I saw this on their Facebook page. You could have another person who saw it come in and authenticate that this was what was on the Facebook page. I saw this on the Facebook page, and this accurately represents what was listed on their Facebook feed. I think that'd probably be the way to do it. Maybe have somebody else, if you're representing a private client, you could have a appointed or private client. If you're representing a person other than the department, you could have that person testify that that's what they saw on the Facebook feed. If you're representing the department, you could have the case manager take a look at it and testify. CASA, of course, could do that as well if they were to testify as to what their observations were. So I think there are a number of ways that you could get that in there. You know, I think as a practical matter, with a lot of these things, you could just say, Judge, it's still on their Facebook page right here. You know, she's still
you know, with him in this compromising picture under the covers, you know, here on the on their Facebook page. In fact, that's their profile picture. So,
a lot of people also get, yes, ma'am. Okay, the question was never mind. A lot of people also get messed up a lot by the fact that the authentication statute requires rule 1001. I love rule 1001. Requires the original, and this is very important when you're talking about a handwriting, a traditional handwriting, an old school writing, right? That you have the original and not a copy, unless you can show some reason why you have to get the copy in. That's sort of beyond the scope of what we're doing today. But for purposes of something that's stored on a computer, any printout is an original, okay? For something that comes from a photographic negative, any print from that is an original. So don't worry about objections for original documents. Once when I was sitting in a case when I was on the bench, I actually watched a really snarky lawyer sort of take a bite out of one of his colleagues who he knew didn't know any better, and he objected over a photograph that it wasn't the original. And once again, there was this long dead air, there was a lot of sputtering and everything, and you know, fortunately somebody else was able to stand up and say, "Judge, you know, that isn't original under the code." And you could see the guy laughing. He was just doing it to sort of throw them off. It's amazing. It happens sometimes.
And where did you have this photograph printed?
Right.
And was it color accurate? You know, that. Yeah. That's
Chain of custody. There's no
chain of custody.
There's no chain of
custody
required for photographs and documents and things like that. So no chain of custody required for these. So don't get thrown off by those. The only question is this look like what it really looked like? Yes. Okay. Then good. You're over those hurdles. Is it an original? Yes, it's an original. So how about experts? We live in a judicial atmosphere that's totally, sometimes I just think we're run by experts, that juvenile court is completely expert driven. And sometimes that's just because of the nature of what we do. And sometimes I think right now, for instance, I recommend to people that in termination cases, because of the status of the case law from the appellate courts, that you have an expert witness to testify to harm. Because I think you're messing up if you don't have an expert witness to testify to harm, unless you have very clear evidence. So we rely on experts all the time in juvenile court, and a lot of people don't really know how to deal with them. And I still say new, 2013, but the fact is the evidence code that we have now substantially changes how you deal with an expert and gives a lot more scope for an alert practitioner to really do some stuff. I really like this quotation from Conrad Lorenz, who's a biologist and an ornithologist. He just keeps saying that in order to be competitive, you know, experts get increasingly narrowed down their expertise so that they can compete with other people. But the problem is, the more and more specialized you get, the less, quantitatively, you really know. And in the end, you finally know everything about nothing, or everything about one little thing. So, I mean, under our old code, it really was, and you still see this with practitioners all the time, well, this person's an expert. Oh, well, okay, it's an expert. What can I say? I can't say anything about it. I mean, I'm going to encourage you to ask lots of questions about experts that are being tendered. Because here's our rule, 702B, this comes straight to us from the federal rules. If scientific, technical, or other specialized knowledge will assist the trier of fact to understand the evidence or determine a fact in issue, then you can use a qualified expert. If the testimony is based on sufficient facts or data, the testimony is a product of reliable principles and methods, and the witness has applied those principles reliably. So we have to unpack this, because this is really, there's a lot here, and this is stuff that we never had to deal with, some of it, before. So first, the first part of this rule is essentially what we had before, since around 1850, without some of this other stuff down here. So basically, before, the only question really for experts was, is this somebody who has specialized knowledge that comes from training, expertise, experience, that's beyond the ken of the average fact finder, right? That was what you really had to ask these folks. And if they did, then okay, you have expertise. And we still have this, but now it's only the entryway to our expert being tendered and admitted as an expert. So this type of knowledge, first off, we need to remember that this is still very broad. You can be an expert because you went to college and studied something, but you can also be an expert because you practice a trade and you do it all the time. You can be an expert in something because you have an extensive hobby that has given you information and expertise beyond what the average person would have. I mean, so it's just a question of being able to bring that out. So that's the first thing to remember.
Has everybody seen My Cousin Vinny?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, his girlfriend is an expert in transmission and differential systems because she spent her whole life growing up around the garage and fixing cars. That's how she became an expert in that. And in fact, it provided rebuttal evidence that was eventually instrumental in winning the case. Why? She was an expert because she had extensive experience with it. There's no, I think, one set of skills or training that's going to be necessary for somebody to be an expert in general, although certainly in certain fields there are going to be minimum qualifications, I think.
But what about all this other stuff? So we have an expert now, but the expert can only testify if these things are met. These last three things come ultimately from the Daubert case, which many of you may be familiar with, which came from the United States Supreme Court in the year that I graduated from law school, and I remember it when it happened, and they said, look, courts have a gatekeeping function they have to play with regard to the entry of, all evidence, but a really important one with regard to the entry of experts, and they need to only admit valid and reliable scientific evidence that fits the case. And then a little bit later in the Kumho Tire case, they said, well, you know what? This is not just scientific evidence. This is any experts. Anytime you have an expert, we need to make sure that you have valid and reliable evidence. Just because of this sort of patina of, you know, glamour that surrounds an expert, as soon as somebody says, yeah, I have this knowledge that you don't have, I have this training experience that you don't have, people tend to kind of roll over and play dead and say, well, then whatever you say must have lots of weight and credibility, oh, expert. And the Supreme Court of the United States, bless you, wanted to preserve us from that and has done so. So what we did in Rule 702 is we don't really use the exact language that Daubert used, but we have codified it into an inquiry about reliability. Okay, you're an expert. Now, how do you take this expertise and apply it to particular facts and get an outcome? How do you make sure that what this expert is talking about is useful to us? Well, first, so we have this idea. You've got knowledge, skill, expertise, training, and education. Great, you got it. How will that assist the trier of fact? We're still not quite to Daubert yet. We got to make sure this is going to have something to do. This is relevance. Okay. It's relevant expert testimony. Once we've decided that we have an expert who is an expert in a field that will assist the trier of fact, the judge in our cases, then we have to ask ourselves these further cases. All right, is there a sufficient basis for your opinion? And did you use reliable principles in reaching your opinion? And did you properly apply those principles and methods? This is so much more involved than it used to be with an expert, and most attorneys that I have observed do not ask experts about this. I'm sure you're all aware of the ability to voir dire an expert witness, right? Okay, because some people aren't. I mean, I said to somebody something about voir dire several years ago. He's like, you can do that? I was like, yeah, you can do that. Let's, you know, as soon as the proponent steps away and says, Judge, I've tendered this guy as an expert in whatever, then you stand up and say, Your Honor, may I voir dire the witness? And then it's time to start asking about these Daubert elements. So let's look at these because it gives a real scope for your voir dire, your trial skills and your advocacy, and it's going to throw the other people off because they're not going to know that you know how to do this. So first, just sufficient basis. We would require this of any witness, and yet we tend to pussyfoot around it with experts because we just say, well, they're experts. But, you know, what do you base your opinion on? What's the raw material that you get your opinion from? What facts or data have you observed that gives you the right to talk about this and form an opinion about it? I mean, any witness that comes in who gives unsupported testimony is simply speculating. You know, anyone. This applies to all witnesses, but we give experts a sort of deference, and we have to be reminded by our code that we need to ask this question with regard to them as well. Support your hypothesis. What methods and principles did you use in order to reach your conclusion? The Daubert case actually gives about 15 different illustrations of the kinds of questions you might ask to determine whether the testimony is a product of reliable principles and methods, and it points out that these are by way of illustration, that they're not exhaustive, but these are some of the ones that most commonly come up. So this theory that you're proposing, Mr. Expert, bless you, has it been tested? Has it been independently tested? Has it been subject to peer review and publication? Well, really, which publication was that? When did that come out? What entity did the peer review? Are there, for like scientific processes and things, are there error rates here? And what are the error rates? How often are you wrong when you do this type of thing? What's the degree of acceptance in the scientific community? Is this generally accepted? Is this the kind of thing that most people in your field do and rely on? Or is this something that you just made up on your own and wrote a book about and are making a lot of money touting right now? Did you develop this just for this or some other litigation purposes? Or were you doing, you know, independent research to try to reach these goals? So these are things that the Supreme Court says we should look into to find out if this testimony is the product of reliable principles and methods. So that's important for us to do. Great scope for voir dire. And then finally, once you know all those things, we know what your facts are you observe. We know what methodology you use. Did you do it right? Did you properly apply the methodology to the facts of the case? Because it's no good if it's been improperly applied. So you need to ask these folks. You miss key evidence if you roll over on expert witnesses and don't routinely voir dire them about these things. And if you're the proponent of the expert witness, then you leave yourself open if you don't ask all this stuff when you first get the witness up there, and more importantly, prepare the witness to answer these questions. Some experts who testify in court a lot are used to answering these kinds of questions, and some of them are not, and will be blown away by them. Because as we all know, legal inquiry is not the normal way people think, right? It's not the normal way people, except for lawyers, it's not the way people think in real life. So they need to be prepared for these things. And if you're on the other side of an expert, you need to be prepared to question and cross-examine the expert about these Daubert principles in order to finally say, okay, judge, I think this is an expert who's properly qualified and will stipulate that it should come in. Or you can say, no, this expert is not properly qualified. Yes?
If you cross-examine this witness and they come through with flying colors, you've kind of created a deity right there in the courtroom.
Well, you know, it's less. This is less dangerous in our bench trials than it is in a jury trial. I mean, I hope that it's something that you should be aware of. But it's much less dangerous than it is in a bench trial than it is in a jury trial, because I hope that our judges are not just, you know, dreamy-eyed looking at, you know, experts and saying, oh yeah, there's an expert on the stand. I can clock out for the next 30 minutes, and when I clock back in, I can say, yep, I find that what you've said is perfectly true.
But one thing I was going to point out in the process of ordering this expert witness, you might have somebody who's the foremost expert in this area. They may be using the best methodology. It may be state-of-the-art methodology for whatever it is that they're doing, or the way that people in their field generally interpret this data. But there's always the question of, what data did you use, and did you apply this data that's specific to this case? Is it complete? Is it comprehensive? Is it everything that you need to come to the conclusion in this specific case? So it's one thing to be an expert generally and to know all sorts of things about a specific area, but you know, they also need to be applying that to the facts so that they can reach an opinion as to what's related to this case. And if they're a really good expert, of course they have. They've been the one to conduct the test themselves, or they've had somebody in their office that conducted the test or obtained the information in the normal process that they obtain the information. But if they haven't, well, I think you've got a good reason to say, well, I don't know that this expert can really testify as to what they would normally be able to provide expert testimony to, because they haven't reviewed or they don't have a basis to form the opinion on the issue specific to this child, really, in these cases, or this parent in this case.
You'd be surprised at how often experts are not prepared to answer these questions. I mean, people in juvenile court are not hard on experts. And most of our experts, especially the ones that have like contracts with DFACs, like, you know, psychologists and people like that, get up and they just, you know, they have a spiel and they just do it every single time. And if you throw them off, sometimes they're not able to recover. So, I mean, there's a lot of people are just not used to being asked these questions. So I don't think that the whole flying colors thing is a real danger in a lot of cases.
Some of them are real good though, but I mean,
there are good ones. Yeah.
But not every one of them is necessary.
Richard has to say that because it's a SAG and this is being recorded.
No. I've seen some, and I've voir dired some of the expert witnesses that I would call in any case these days because I know, you know, they've been put through the ringer on exactly this sort of thing.
Yeah.
A lot of times, particularly when you're picking an expert witness to call in your case, it's very helpful to know whether or not that expert is going to be reliable and going to be useful. We once had a private client who insisted upon us calling an expert witness who was the worst expert witness ever. In fact, the court's finding was, I find for the plaintiff, however, none of the testimony from the expert witness was considered in any capacity by this court because this expert is completely unreliable and was using unreliable methods and reached unreliable conclusions. So there are experts that are so bad. In fact, in that same instance, that same expert witness, another attorney called them later in a case, in their case in chief. By the end of my cross-examination of that witness, I had that witness agreeing with the opposing parties, that was my client's case in chief. Why? Because that was the worst expert imaginable.
Mm-hmm. One of the worst witnesses ever.
I agree. That was absolutely famously bad in that courthouse. So
we have a... We're nearing the end. Just be patient. We've got about 20 minutes left, so we got to kind of hurry through the last two areas that we need to talk about. The first one is privilege and confidentiality, because these are also things we can talk about this very quickly, but people don't get this a lot, so it's useful to talk about the difference between privilege and confidentiality. A privilege is something that protects against being compelled to testify. Okay, privileged communications don't come in. All right, they don't. So the common ones that you deal with in juvenile court are the attorney-client privilege, the spousal privilege, and the mental health privilege, psychologist, psychiatrist, social workers, counselor, patient, that privilege. Of course, the clergy privilege for purposes of confession and pastoral things is also very important. I don't see it that much, so I didn't mention it, but it's as absolute as the others. So privilege, something that's privileged, does not come in, does not get testified to. So just keep that in mind. Confidential communications, however, are subject under certain circumstances to legal compulsion. And in Georgia, this is something people forget a lot of times, the doctor-patient relationship is a confidential but not a privileged relationship. Okay, so medical doctors, the physical side of things, are confidential but not privileged, unlike the mental health side.
And a lot of times you'll hear people saying, well, you cannot bring that into court. That's HIPAA protected information.
I got a HIPAA slide.
Oh, well then never mind.
Yeah.
You missed that one.
I added some stuff today at the last minute.
Okay.
So let's talk about this. What about these court-ordered mental evaluations that we have? Right? There's a case about this. It's great. There is no privilege regarding most court-ordered mental health evaluations. We've had attorneys do this all the time. You know, well, you're not going to get my client's psychological in because that's privileged, and we're just not going to agree to it. But the Georgia Supreme Court said in 2005, look, when the court orders a psychologist to come in and do an evaluation, and it's not part of an ongoing relationship of treatment and evaluation, it's just evaluating a person's mental state because you've got a court order to do so, no treatment is given or contemplated, then that evaluation is not privileged. Okay, so those mental health evaluations are not normally privileged. Court-ordered ones.
And what would be the point of if it were? I mean, it's court-ordered.
Right.
It's supposed to come back for consideration to determine what the best outcome is for the child. And so it would need to be able to be admissible.
So just it's not given, that mental health treatment is not given or contemplated. I mean, a lot of times we are contemplating treatment, just maybe not by that evaluator.
The question is the relationship between that evaluator
and that
person.
But yes. Once the parent agrees to go, and there is no court order at that point,
right.
The parent is agreeing to go and get this evaluation, could the argument then be made that it's not court order?
I guess the question then is what's the contemplated scope of that relationship? Are you just going in to get an evaluation, or do you intend to place yourself under the care of that person?
I mean, if you're just going to get an evaluation, which happens so often in our cases, and
that's
you're
not
just,
paid for by DFACS?
Yeah. Well, yeah, that right. Didn't happen that often.
Right.
It does happen sometimes. But if you just go in and get an evaluation and leave, then that is not protected. Okay. So this is an exception to the mental health privilege. And the other one is HIPAA. HIPAA never applies to court-ordered discovery or testimony. You will hear people yell and scream about HIPAA, but if there's a court order, like a subpoena or court order discovery, HIPAA does not apply. So don't be frightened by people talking about HIPAA. I can't talk about that. That's HIPAA. Well, no, it's not HIPAA. It's a court order. So Mr. Person on the stand, you have a subpoena, you're going to testify about this. You're going to answer the questions, even if outside on the street, this might be HIPAA-protected information.
Right.
So HIPAA does not apply in most court settings at all.
So my client, the doctor, will never testify to this because it's HIPAA-protected information.
Yeah.
And of course, all you have to do is get them in court, and they will be compelled to testify as to that.
Right.
And I mean, it's important that there be appropriate protections for that. But one of the protections for those things is that although a lot of these proceedings without a court order are open court proceedings, the records themselves are to be maintained in confidentiality and only to be used in the proceeding before the juvenile court that you're actually present in. So you can't then turn around and take those medical records and introduce the same things that were obtained in the juvenile court proceeding in the divorce action that the parties are having. They could get the same records, but they're going to have to arrive at them through independent means. They can't be the same stuff that you got pursuant to a court order or that was produced in the actual juvenile court proceeding itself.
All right, so the last thing we need to talk about, and you'll wonder at first, why didn't we talk about this when we were talking about hearsay? This is very important in juvenile court cases, right? Child hearsay. And people who have known me for a long time know that this is my pet peeve. Well, it's one of about 1,000, but it's a big one for me. Okay, child hearsay, because Georgia's child hearsay statute is not a child hearsay statute. Let's talk about why. Let's look at Georgia's child hearsay statute. Here it is, it's Rule 820, our beloved child hearsay statute. So it requires that the statement you're trying to get in be made by a child under 16 years of age. It has to be a statement describing an act of sexual conduct or physical abuse, either with the child as the victim or witnessed on another person in the presence of the child. as long as now the person who wants to get this in provides prior notice to the other parties of the intention to use this, the child testifies at trial, unless waived, and then the person to whom the child made the statement is subject to cross-examination. So why isn't this a child hearsay statute? Well, the person who's communicating the child hearsay is subject to cross-examination.
The child has to testify.
Unless somebody waives their testimony. And what happens when somebody says, well, you know, you don't have to call this witness because we agree with this summary of the witness's statement? Well, that's not hearsay. That's a stipulation, right? If Richard comes in and says, here, my doctor wrote this down. I don't want to call him. Can we just put this in instead? And I say yes, then it doesn't matter. I mean, we're not talking about hearsay. We're not talking about admissibility. We're just saying this comes in. It's stipulated to. You don't need a statute that says we can stipulate to testimony. So basically, we have a statute that says, a child hearsay statute that requires that the child testify unless there's a stipulation. Well, in that case, we have a witness hearsay statute in Georgia as well, because every witness is required to come in and testify unless they're stipulated to. I mean, it makes absolutely no sense. The reason we got here is because our old rule was really, really bad. The old rule basically said some of the same things, slightly different, but it said that you could get this statement in as long as the child was available to testify. And there was all this sort of rigmarole about what that meant and whether that sufficiently protected people or not. And the appellate courts jumped in and said, you know, this is not a constitutional protection. We need to put some protections in. And basically what they did at a time prior to our new evidence code was they took some protections from the catch-all statute in the federal rules and put them in here, which is basically that everything has to be served on the other parties in advance. There has to be sufficient indicia of reliability before it comes in. And so when we came up with the new evidence code, the legislature rewrote this in order to comply with our appellate court's decision, which I think is such a bad idea because it's completely inconsistent. I just tell people all the time, all of our statutes regarding witness testimony, if this is a hearsay statute, they're all hearsay statutes. And this is nonsensical because for those reasons. It's also a bad idea because we've done away with the idea of availability here. I mean, one of the two big distinctions in the types of hearsay exceptions there are those exceptions where you have a witness who's unavailable and those exceptions where it doesn't matter if the witness is unavailable. So what happens in a case if you have a child who is not physically unavailable to testify, but is psychologically unavailable to testify? It really doesn't matter. If there's no waiver, that child has to get on the stand and testify. If you want to use this information, it doesn't matter. There's no question to be asked by the court about the effect it's going to have on the child, the effect it's going to have on anybody else. There are some protections we can use by having children testify, you know, out of the physical presence of other people, but a lot of our courthouses don't have sufficient technology to do that. And in fact, this is something that comes up when you talk about child hearsay, and I just threw it in here because a lot of people are not familiar with this distinction between non-testimonial and testimonial hearsay. This distinction played a role in getting us the statute we have today. So non-testimonial hearsay, an example is like the police going out to stop an emergency and running in and saying, what happened? And they say, this guy shot that guy. Well, the police aren't interrogating anybody. They're trying to respond to an emergency. That's still hearsay, but it's non-testimonial hearsay, and it doesn't trigger constitutional protections regarding incrimination and things like that. Whereas testimonial hearsay is stuff garnered in the context of an investigation. The fact is, some child hearsay statements may be able to come in under other exceptions to the hearsay statute that we haven't talked about today, like excited utterances. or statements made to doctors for purposes of medical diagnosis and treatment. They may. But we deal with a lot of police interrogations and forensic interviews in our cases. And those are testimonial types of hearsay, in which case you're going to have the child come in and testify. And there's no way around it if there's not a stipulation, which is a shame because we have this 807 residual exception. And it's almost exactly the same as the federal residual exception. The federal rules of evidence don't have a child hearsay statute. So how do you deal with child hearsay in federal courts? You use the residual exception. There's a well-developed body of case law about the use of the residual exception, Rule 807, to get in child hearsay because it offers all of the protections that our statute tries to offer, except it also offers the ability not to call the child if all of these things are met, if the prior notice is met, if general reliability is met, if the party who's passing on the child hearsay is available to come in and testify and be cross-examined, all of these things. So we actually have a way to get child hearsay in without our non-child hearsay, child hearsay statute. I once asked Professor Millage at a judges conference why we got this stupid rule when they had a chance to rewrite us. Why don't they just get rid of 820 and let us go under 807 like the feds do and so many other states do? And he said, it's just politics. He said, nobody wants to go on the record as wanting to get rid of the child hearsay statute. Because it would be seen, I guess, that they're, you know, anti-child or anti-child victims. But in reality, this would provide more protection for children than our child hearsay, non-child hearsay statute. So while you're out there advocating and talking to your legislators and things like that, you should hit them up about the child hearsay, non-child hearsay statute. And I think that it's absolutely ridiculous. It's a dinosaur. So there is no child hearsay exception. If you want child hearsay to come in, it's not going to happen, okay, unless people stipulate to it. And most people, in cases involving the kind of cases where you have child hearsay, they usually involve serious allegations of abuse or neglect. Abuse, sexual or physical abuse. Most people who have smart counsel are not going to stipulate to allow those sorts of things to come in. It's not like a jury trial situation where you may be afraid that if you call the child, the jury's going to hate you. Most responsible counsel are probably going to say, no, I'm not going to stipulate to those serious allegations coming in. I'm going to make you call the child. So we don't have a child hearsay statute. Yes, ma'am.
So as an alternative route, could I bring in the forensic interviewer and have them lay the foundation to enter their forensic interview like synopsis into evidence? And within that synopsis, it says what the child...
No, because that's testimonial hearsay, not non-testimonial hearsay, and so it's not going to come in over an objection. Yes?
Maybe as a narrative, it may be possible if it's discussing an injury received by the child.
But I think only those portions of it that discuss the injury and not those portions of it that discuss who committed the injury, unless they fall under some other hearsay, like the doctor needs to know in order to diagnose and treat who did it, or there's an excited utterance or something like that. I think in most cases, that information, which is what you really want, is going to get redacted.
Could a forensic interview of the synopsis, the report, be a business record, or is that a stretch?
No.
Because they do it all the time?
No, because it's prepared in anticipation for litigation, which is a common exception. Yes.
I think it's in Ohio versus Clark.
Don't know.
That there was a 3-year-old. He had some bruises. The daycare staff member asked him, "Have you been hit?" He said no. He eventually said, "Yes, I've been hit." Who did it? D did it, which was his mother's boyfriend. Mm-hmm. And I think that finally got in base that it was non-testimonial hearsay.
I know that our courts have been one case that comes to mind as illustrative of this distinction between testimonial and non-testimonial, but in this case the court kind of punted, which I think our courts do a lot in this, was an incident where there was a 911 call that there was a problem in a hotel room and somebody was in danger. That's all they got. And the police knocked on the door, and when there was no response, they opened the door and came in, and they found mom and the child, but the perpetrator had already left. And they said, "What happened?" And mom said, "I walked in and found, you know, Mr. Scumbag on top of my daughter, and all their clothes were off." And I said, "What's going on?" And she told me what he did to her. And there was some graphic language there. And then the police later on brought the child in for a forensic interview and talked. So what the Court of Appeals said was, okay, if you want to talk about the child's immediate outcry to the mother, that's okay. Okay, because that's an excited utterance. I walk in, I say, "What's going on?" If you want to talk about what came out of this forensic interview, that doesn't come in because that's testimonial. What about the mother's statement to the police when they were coming in to rectify an emergency? And the court said, you know, that is so fact intensive, we're going to kick that back to the trial court to make a determination about whether they needed to know that to quell the emergency or not. So,
which would make it non-testimonial.
Which would make it non-testimonial.
Which is, I guess, where the Supreme Court came down.
Right.
I have to admit, I was left befuddled.
Yeah.
Several times after
there's,
reading that.
We don't. I mean, we don't have good in Georgia, and I think in the federal level, it's a little bit different. And I'm not sure about other states, but in Georgia, we don't have good appellate guidance about this issue. Especially where you're talking about non-testimonial or testimonial hearsay regarding child abuse and sexual and physical abuse. So, but the takeaway is we don't have a child hearsay statute. So if you want to use a child hearsay statute, you'll have to go someplace else. So keep in mind, again, our broad goals of informed judicial decision making. It's you who, as the advocates in court, who make sure, hold the court's feet to the fire, who make them accountable. Courts rely very heavily upon counsel to do their jobs and to be zealous advocates. These goals are only met where you have zealous counsel who are willing to stand up and say the right things and do the right things, even if it's uncomfortable to do so. So I hope you'll do that. And if you have questions, you can let us know. Thank you.